stop that rushing attack.
You have been able to stop Gus Malzahn's rushing attack. He has instantly gotten the Tigers back to where they always expect to be, contending for a title. And Brett Bielema, year one at Arkansas, after guiding Wisconsin to three straight Rose Bowls, has been applying his system, aiming for long-term success. They're currently in the midst of a five-game losing streak. Arkansas won the toss, and they will receive. Corliss Marshall back for Cody Parker's kick, and he will take a knee. One of the big stories this week has been the health of the Auburn quarterback, as we say hello to Maria Taylor.
That's right, Tess. You know, Nick Marshall injured his right shoulder last week against Florida Atlantic, but Gus Malzahn says he will be his starter. That's despite the fact that he's been limited in practice all week. In fact, he did not start throwing until Thursday, but the staff believes that he's paid attention to detail in film and in meetings, and that should not hinder him here today.
Thank you, Maria. So we will wait to see Marshall. For now, it is Brandon Allen and that Arkansas offense that could use a little boost with some explosion on the outside. We talked to offensive coordinator Jim Chaney plenty about that. They rely on their running game. Jonathan Williams will be the tailback here to start the game, and it's a good run to get things going. A first down push by Jonathan Williams.
A nice start for that Arkansas offense. They've got to be able to run the football, Tess, and when they're on, these impact players brought to you by Chick-fil-A are the guys who do it. Alex Collins, just a freshman, exciting. Kiro Small, the fullback, really involved in the offense. And D Ford, the defensive end out of Auburn, he's got to come up big against this run game.
Jonathan Williams, the lone back. And his play action here, Allen had a lot of pressure on top of him that time. That was D Ford, who has six sacks on the year for the Tigers.
Those of you at home are thinking, is that intentional grounding? The answer is no. D Ford got on top of him. He was still kind of on the outskirts of the pocket, but there was a receiver in the area, and so they won't call that.
D Ford leads Auburn in sacks. He's second in the conference in sacks per game, so he's been really good off the edge this year. Williams on second and 10, and once again a good hole. He gets to the outside, and another first down from his efforts out to midfield. Good block by the receiver, Hatcher.
Brandon Allen, Tess. Brandon Allen is going to have to pick his spots. If they're going to win today, Brandon Allen is going to have to make the throws when they ask him. Look, this is going to be a team that's going to have to really rely on the run game all game long. But when Allen is called upon to make a throw, he's got to be able to be accurate.
He's a sophomore. He beat out the fifth-year senior Brandon Mitchell back in spring ball. Mitchell ended up transferring to NC State. And once again, a big hole for Jonathan Williams, this time off the left side, finally taken down by Ryan Smith.
Now, we talked to you about Alex Collins, but Jonathan Williams, just as capable, a thicker guy, harder to bring down, has really good instincts inside the tackles. As you can see in these last few runs, he has very good vision and quick feet in the hole.
He has started every game, even though it's Alex Collins, the superb freshman who comes in now, who has gotten more carries on the year. And there is number three, the true freshman from Florida. And one, Allen with time goes downfield, and they strike first. Javonte Herndon.
Oh.
And was he juggling that ball? Yes, that's incomplete. As the stadium celebrates, the game officials counseling there in the back of the end zone, and they rule it incomplete as the coverage came from Jonathan Mincy. Watch the end of this play.
And we can't see the ball. It's away from us, and they're going to review that. He has to have, this would be a better, he has to have control all the way through. There's control. He's still, ooh, you know what? That's a tough one. No, he still doesn't have control all the way through, Tess. He was still bobbling it when he hit the ground. Mincy does a nice job with that arm over the top and follows through and rakes it.
Complete pass. The previous play is under further review.
There's the rake. Now he has to complete the catch. Right, and he hits the ground. you can't, there, you see the ball still bobbling? That's what the official sees. You see the side judge, the guy with the yes right there on his back? That's perfect position for an official to be able to view it.
That's James Carter, the side judge, with his SEC crew here, led by Matt Leffler.
Now, lost in all that, Tess, we just got done telling you, when Brandon Allen had the opportunity to present it to himself, he had to be able to deliver it. Well, that's a perfect throw. Herndon comes down with it, needed. See, right there, his foot is, one is out, one is in, but watch right at the end. Still bobbling, they'll call that incomplete. I think that's a good call. You have to complete it, Tess. You have to control it, rather, all the way through the completion of the catch, and
yep,
that's all the way
to
the ground.
Control through the process of the catch. At that point, clearly he does, but this is all part of the equation. They're looking to see, do you control it throughout? And here's the call.
After further review, the ruling is confirmed. It is an incomplete pass. Yeah,
good call. Well officiated, nicely done by the side judge, and also extremely well defended by Mincy. Never gave up on a test. Followed through with that rake right through the offensive player.
No, that's exactly what we said when we started this series, opened up the game, that Jim Chaney, their offensive coordinator, was looking for. They wanted explosive plays on the edge. So it makes it third and one. And Allen should have good half yard there ahead of the line to make, and it's a first down for Arkansas.
You know, this is a young interior with one exception. You have two freshmen on either side. You got Skipper 76, Kirkland 55. And I'm going to tell you, there's a guy, Travis Swanson, 64. Tess, I think he's the best center I've seen all season.
And the coaching staff would agree with you. He has started every game of his career. Now 47 games for the senior center, Travis Swanson.
What makes him good? He sees everything, but he's really mobile. He's very good to the second level, and they pull him quite a bit.
Here's Alex Carter. You get a glimpse of the athleticism of the true freshman.
Collins got some juice. You see those quick feet inside. They're not afraid to run him inside, and he has the speed to get to the edge.
Collins, arguably the best freshman running back in the country. Leads all freshmen coming into today with 797 total rushing yards this season. And here's Guerrero Small, a useful senior fullback, comes in and replaces Collins.
Now what's going on with Auburn right now, as they've given up yet another first down, is they are starting to commit eight guys to the line of scrimmage. Arkansas is taking it to them in the run game. They'll start to commit. So now it's going to go back to Brandon Allen.
Ellis Johnson, the defensive coordinator for Auburn, one of the real veterans of this conference.
Look at him drop down. Here he goes, right at the line of scrimmage. That's a seven-man front at the line of scrimmage with two behind.
Allen connects. The flag is down as he's able to get it to Hatcher.
Offside on the defense, number 27, 5-yard penalty, replay first down.
Tess, that's the scenario we were talking about. Ellis Johnson, when he starts committing numbers to the defense for the run game, then Brandon Allen has got to respond. He doesn't have to get everything. He just has to find the open guy and be accurate. Continue to move the chains.
After the penalty, it's a first and five.
Here it comes down again.
And they go with Jonathan Williams again, but he is stacked up right at the line of scrimmage. That was Casanova McKenzie with the tackle.
Look up front against that Auburn defensive front. The one guy who really jumps out to me is number 90. Gabe Wright is a guy who's got some good quickness. He's got some explosion at the point. Right now, he's taking his break, but when he's in, he's the guy who's the motor to that front.
Here's Allen sprinting to the near side on second and five. Tucks it, runs it, and slides about a yard and a half short.
That's Jim Chaney. He's the offensive coordinator for Arkansas. Just when we talked to him the other day, he said, look, we know we've been struggling, but we also know that we have a couple pieces of the puzzle. Ooh, Brandon Allen's limping right now. One of the things he wanted to do was get him outside and not be continually in one spot. And this is the part of the piece of the puzzle that that they wanted to utilize, was him getting on the edge.
Looks like some of the Auburn players got the worst of it, as they tend to Brandon Allen, sophomore starting quarterback. A.J. Derby, the junior transfer from Iowa, is warming up. Take a short break. See if Derby will be entering the game here. Looked like Allen may have been stepped on at the end of that play. On their opening 10-play drive of the game, they've gone 55 yards. There is Allen being taken off, and he's replaced by the junior A.J. Derby on this third down and one.
I would load the box. You're counting on the fact they're not going to put the ball in Derby's hands.
And they go with the fullback, Small, and he breaks free for a good gain inside the 15. That was a good surge by Kiero Small. A.J. Derby started the game at Rutgers. He went 14 of 26, 137 yards, had a touchdown in that loss. His father played with that guy, his head coach Brett Bielema, when they were up there at Iowa. That's where A.J. started his career, played in only three games there.
A little trickeration here, Tess.
And now they're going with the trick play. They go wildcat with Collins. He's patiently looking for blocks, but he was contained right there at the line of scrimmage. So Derby transferred to a junior college and then eventually came to Arkansas when dad's friend got the job here.
Jim Chaney, the offensive coordinator, knows what he has exactly right here. And so I would expect to see a heavy run game. Now, Ellis Johnson knows the same thing, so I would expect to counter that with more people down inside to stop the run. Here he comes. Here they come down. Tight coverage. That's smart.
And here's Derby to pass. And that was batted down and intercepted. That is McKenzie. After D. Ford deflected it, McKenzie hauled it in. Auburn ball.
Watch D. Ford, number 30, right down here. He gets his hand up. Nicely done.
And then Casanova McKenzie. It'll be Auburn on offense when we come back. Derby's pass deflected, and McKenzie comes up with the interception. So the running game of Auburn will get going here with Trey Mason, as he has done most of the year. He averages 94 rushing yards a game. That was a 15-yard gain to get things going. And now you know the Gus Malzahn offense that you've seen for years. Up-tempo and a lot of runs out of the spread. Trey Mason again. The impact player is brought to you by Chick-fil-A for this matchup of Auburn's offense against the Arkansas defense.
Well, it's easy to see what they like with Trey Mason. And then Sammy Coates on the outside. Filon in the inside is a big-time player, and they've got to be able to get him. Flowers, 86, is also going to have to be part of the equation.
Trey Mason off to a very good start. As he wants that tempo and that pace, Gus Malzahn. Can't go much quicker than this. Nick Marshall. And the quarterback quickly getting the ball down to the 33-yard line. 18-yard gain by the junior. And right to the line of scrimmage again. This time Mason just about 2 yards on the right side of the line, tackled by Phylon. Averaging a play every 24.6 seconds. Nearly 6 seconds faster than they were a year ago. That's a dangerous receiver they have in Sammy Coates as well. As you see, Gus Malzahn, the Arkansas native, directing traffic. And Brett Bielema, he's been pretty public about his distaste for up-tempo.
The left tackle, 73,
Greg Robbins. On the offense, number 73, 5-yard penalty, second down.
And that's one way to slow it down. There's a lump made between Brett Bielema's run-ins and issues with Auburn and some on the coaching staff. They heated up even this summer at SEC Media Days. One of the hot topics is Nick Saban and Brett Bielema and their position against the hurry-up spread offenses. We'll get into a bit of that a little later on. Second and 13 after the flag. Mason. And a tackle for loss that time as Trey Flowers was in the backfield.
Flowers is probably their best defender and probably their smartest player on this team. He has great football intelligence.
9.5 tackles for loss now for Trey Flowers. Third and 15. And they go with the screen, and Coates goes the wrong direction. And that green line you see is the field goal range for their senior kicker, Cody Parkey. And they're just beyond it as it stands right now.
Flowers got into that, but Carroll Washington, number 21, that was a very well done. He read it right away. He saw Coates was getting in that screen, and he jumped it and got in on that tackle.
So Stephen Clark in the punt, senior from Kansas City, been a four-year punter for the Tigers. And he gets that back rotation here, just trying to pin them. And it takes a perfect bounce and is covered up right around the two-yard line. Perfect execution on special teams by Stephen Clark and Sammy Coates. Exactly what he wanted, and he gets it as Clark pins him thanks to Coates. For Missouri as they play Tennessee and then Winston against the Canes and then get a good dose of Johnny Manziel in action once we finish up here. And as Arkansas back on offense with Brandon Allen, the quarterback, from their own end zone stacked up. Boy, that was dangerous with Jonathan Williams. And good surge, though, by the entire offensive line just to create some breathing room on the second effort.
We talked about the center, Travis Swanson, but there's a couple of freshmen on the interior, 76. That's Skipper, 6'10", and on the other side, Denver Kirkland, number 55. But watch the power, like a scrum. It just keeps on moving forward, and they got a little, about 2 yards there, maybe a yard and a half, 2 yards.
Yeah, Kirkland and Skipper, the Razorbacks and UCLA, the only teams in the country to start at least two true freshmen on the offensive line.
That's the tallest football player in captivity right there.
6'10" is Dan Skipper. Here's Williams again.
And here comes the scrum.
As he gets just beyond the 8-yard line, it was Whitehead the first to get to him.
Now, people may be sitting at home, you see number 76 there, and he goes, 6'10", 320 or 15 pounds, whatever it is. And I got to tell you, that's a disadvantage, Tess. That's the big old, there's a scrum going on, and there may be a nice little tap. That was Skipper, an overhand right.
Well, he's got good reach. He's like better than Larry Holmes had back in the day.
It's tough, though. Yeah, I'll take Holmes up.
No doubt.
Anytime.
Best jab in history, for the record.
Easton PA, the Easton Assassins.
That was awkward there on the snap, but that's good enough for the first down to Hatcher. Yeah, as A.J. Derby in for Brandon Allen, who left on their first series with an injury.
That's a big-time play right there by Derby. Had the wherewithal, you know, they fumbled the snap, had the wherewithal to pick it up and still find the receiver on the outside. Hatcher is able to find the hole in the zone. That's good poise.
This drive started on the 2-yard line just to get that ball out of the danger zone out to the 14.
Here comes the safety dropped again.
And here is Alex Collins. And there's the explosive burst that Collins can offer up.
That's good vision by Collins. 17-yard gain. They brought pressure from the top right side. He saw it, kicked over to the left. Another 17 yards.
And once again, an issue with the snap between Swanson and Allen. And they're fighting for the ball. And it's Auburn who has it. Second turnover tonight by Arkansas. I think that's Chris Frost in the bottom of that pile. Yeah, there's Frost, the middle linebacker, coming up with the ball. So A.J. Derby, how many times do you see a quarterback warming up, just practicing snaps, the backup, when he thinks he could get into the game? Two times here on this drive, he had an issue.
Good teams, yeah, I hate to say this, but teams that struggle, they beat themselves. This is it. Look at his hands. That's awful. That is awful. He started to pull out, and his hands were separated. You can't do that. I don't care if you're a freshman in high school, you don't do that.
-8 turnover margin for Arkansas now this year. As Auburn starts from the 29, Trey Mason. And Mason is driven down, and a flag comes down.
Look at a horse collar.
As Mitchell took him down at the 9-yard line.
There's no foul for horse collar tackle. First down.
20-yard run by Mason.
You see him at the end. He's got his hand up around his neck.
Yeah, he's not down
instead
there behind
down,
the pass.
Yeah, that's
in
a good
the jersey
call.
There. That was a good call by the crew. Mason gets free and scores. So the lost fumble costly for Arkansas as Trey Mason has his 10th rushing touchdown of the season. And that swinging gate formation, that was the stuff of much controversy early in the week between these staffs. And now they get into the traditional extra point formation for Parkey. ...85 in a row now, extra points for Parkey, as Trey Mason made quick work of it for the Tigers. At Kenseth, locked up atop the Chase standings. Jeff Gordon's closing fast, and coverage will begin Sunday at 2:00 Eastern on ESPN. Marshall back deep with kick that bounces through the end zone. And take a short break. Number 11 Auburn up early.
Defense. So this defensive end has this gap. This is this gap. This backer has this gap. We're a gap. That's called the A gap here. This backer right here has Brooks Ellis, has him. And on the outside, that gap. Well, what happens at the snap of the ball? Brooks Ellis sees a hole and jumps back inside. So he didn't maintain the integrity of the defense, and Mason made him pay for it. Yep. Everything is based on discipline tests, and if you don't have the discipline, you get scores like that.
Look how well Auburn's doing, outscoring opponents, points off turnovers. Brandon Allen is back into the game for Arkansas, the starting quarterback who left after the first series with a right leg injury.
Take it and run.
Chased down that time by McKenzie. McKenzie's the player that had the interception earlier.
That's pretty good by McKinney coming inside out. He's got a little hitch in his get along right there, but he's back out there. One thing we learned, and we know this at every level of football, you can't beat yourself. The two fumbles that they had, or the interception rather, two turnovers, that's not winning football. You've got to eliminate all that.
You remember that was A.J. Derby who threw the interception and fumbled the snap. On the pitch, this is Collins, and he is dragged down to the line of scrimmage. Maria?
Yeah, guys, Brandon Allen sprinted right back on the field, and he told his team, especially Alex Collins, that he was completely fine. Now, it looks like he has a little bit of a shin wrap. There's a lot of extra cushioning on that right shin. You see he still has a little bit of a limp, but he's been trying to run it off here on the sideline.
Thanks, Maria. Third down and seven. And they have converted their first three third downs so far tonight.
Looks like they got tight man coverage outside, Tess.
He just threw it at the feet of Williams as there was a bit of pressure on him.
There's
that
a flag.
Time. And a flag does come down. And it comes down out at the 43-yard line on the near side.
I like what Ellis Johnson did there. He went tight man-to-man and tight underneath. They were going to try to run a screen, so they jumped it right away. There's nowhere to go with the ball.
After the play, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 11 on the defense. That's a 15-yard play from the 16 spot. Automatic, first down.
Well, Gus is hot over that. That's his cornerback, Chris Davis, the best cover corner, as they had defensed that play well. But instead, it's going to be now a first down for the Razorbacks.
Well, Gus ain't too pleased with that one, is he?
No. Collins. Going to be taken down for a loss. Let's go back to that 15-yard penalty with Chris Davis.
Yeah, watch this right down here. See that?
Matched up with Cowan.
Yeah, game's fine. And then, boom, they came back, and that's what they're going to call. They're going to call that every time. There was a push from the offensive player first, and the second one is what got called. Malzahn not too pleased.
Here's Allen on second and 11. That was a good throw downfield as they get it complete that time to Herndon.
Nice throw by Allen. Nice anticipation. And Herndon in the right spot coming back to the ball. It's really a tough throw to defend when you're coming back off that kind of a comeback.
Nick Marshall looks on. As this could be the last play of the first quarter. And they go with the end around off the pitch. This is Hatcher. As they went with Williams, and then they pitched it to Hatcher coming around on a reverse, taken down by Chris Davis. So Arkansas on the move, trailing by a touchdown at home, end of one. Maria with you, ESPN College Football Primetime, as you're watching the SEC. On ESPN. Start of the second quarter here between number 11 Auburn and Arkansas. Arkansas eight quarters now without scoring, but they're moving the ball here against the Tigers. Second and five.
Another eight-man front there. Ellis Johnson is daring him to throw.
Said they pitch to Williams, who gets outside, and he's going to toss it downfield. And that is beyond the reach of Herndon. So we have seen a few trick plays already by offensive coordinator Jim Chaney. Just trying to spark something with a team that, you know, that stretch of eight quarters. Remember, they scored first against South Carolina back on October 12th, and then 111 unanswered points when you tack on the seven here by Auburn tonight.
Jim Chaney, he's been around it. He knows what he has. I really like visiting with him yesterday. He knows exactly what he needs to do, and he knows he's going to have a little bit of luck, too. And here's a nice third down. See if any of that luck shows up.
They run it straight up the middle with Collins, and he will move the chains as Arkansas will have a first down at the 23-yard line.
Well, the luck didn't show up, but Collins did. And what he did is he's following inside Travis Swanson, that senior center. You know, watch him. Nice block on the backside, and then here comes the big skipper. Picks up 15 on third and five, and that's a big deal.
True freshman running back from South Plantation High School down there in Fort Lauderdale. End around with Hatcher. Initial contact was made at the 20. He got about another yard and a half after that.
Tess, one of the guys that you and I really liked, we were talking about this Arkansas team, is the fullback, Carroll Small. Not a real big guy.
Team captain.
Yeah, tough guy. Tough guy, good hands out of the backfield. But you want to talk about power, and you want to talk about getting the dirty work done, Small gets it done.
I'm going to go Wildcat here this time with Kiero Small. And here he is, Matt, as he just tries to get a little pad leverage that time and go ahead for 3 yards. What an interesting road to arrive at this point his senior year for Small. He went to Valley Forge Military Academy over near you.
Oh, yeah.
Didn't work out. He left. Worked at his dad's t-shirt shop in Baltimore. Decided to go back to football. Played a little JUCO. Came to Arkansas. Broke his foot. Missed a year. Medical redshirt. And now this, his fifth year.
He gets it. And he loves it. And he's a good player. But we're down to third and four here.
Third down and four. Allen with time, going to take a shot. And that was Herndon, who was running out of bounds as he, Allen put it to the outside that time. So it'll be fourth down. Zach Hocker. He's 5 for 5 inside of 40 yards this year. And the SEC's active career leader in field goals made gets Arkansas on the board. When we come back, how an ESPN college basketball analyst paved the path for a future Christian high school nearby by ESPN's college basketball analyst Jimmy Dykes, who was the AD. Maria?
That's right. You know, Jimmy, you were a basketball player at Arkansas. Your wife was a cheerleader here, but you ignited the career of Gus Malzahn when you hired him at Shiloh Christian. What were some of the characteristics you saw in him that made you want to give him the job?
You know, I saw the same things I see in Gus Malzahn tonight, same things I see in Brett Bielema tonight. Great coaches all across the country. You know, I saw a determination, a drive, a passion. I saw a guy that could see the finished product before the finished product was ever there. So it was a no-brainer for me when I talked to him, but I never thought the day that I hired him at Shiloh Christian High School, he would be the head coach at Auburn like he is tonight. So I'm very, very happy for him.
Well, let's talk about the very first time you were on the field with him, the first game you played Prairie Grove, and it was a loss. What do you remember from that game?
Oh, man, it wasn't a good start, I tell you that. You know, about the middle of the third quarter, we were getting hammered like 35-0. I was standing by Gus. And our own fans hollered down at me, "Hey, Dykes, way to hire a coach." And we kind of both looked at each other and kept going. And you know what? The other team's players were helping us with the cramps. That's how bad it was.
We'll get back to Jimmy in a moment, but that was an onside kick attempt that was recovered by Auburn.
Offside
by Mitchell.
On the kicking team, number 83. That 5-yard penalty enforced from where Auburn recovered it. First down, Auburn.
Now, something very unique by Brett Bielema. Three kickers in the center of the field there. It was John Henson who did the kicking. All three of them, Hocker, Henson, and Irwin Hill, they could go in any direction, and this is what they came up with. So an onside kick in a 7-3 game in the second quarter. Let's get back to Maria with Jimmy Dykes.
You know, Jimmy, you also moonlight as a football analyst. I know everyone knows you as an ESPN college basketball analyst, but what do you think about this Arkansas offense? I know you're a little bit of a fan. You've come to a lot of games. Tell me what you're seeing.
You know, I love the system that Brett Bielema has in place. You saw in that opening drive, you know, they hammered that ball right at Auburn, went down, and that's what Brett Bielema has always done. He's had roadside, tractor-size offensive linemen. That's what he's going to build it around. Look at Arkansas's best players. They're in that freshman and sophomore class, and that's really hard to handle in an unforgiving league like the SEC. But he's going to get it done, I have no doubt.
All right, well, thanks so much for joining us, Jimmy.
All right, anytime.
Nice visit with Jimmy. Here's Marshall now as he finds Grant out of the backfield. And Corey Grant lowers the shoulder, and they'll move the chains as Auburn has a first down. Onside kick there, Matt, after putting a field goal through.
Well, Brett Bielema knows that the deck is stacked against him. He understands that. So he's trying to even the deck a little bit, but it didn't work right there.
And instead, he gives Auburn a short field. First down at the 24-yard line. And Trey Mason has come back in as the tailback with Nick Marshall in the backfield. And here's Mason. Look at that hole for Mason. Another first down for the Tigers to the 12.
It's just the quickness. Now, once he sees a little bit of light, he's in it really quickly, Tess.
Quick to snap again as Mason spins his way this time to the 7-yard line.
The offensive line, they're not asking them to blow them off the ball. What they're asking them to do is just kind of get in the way and get, if they can get a push, get a push, but if not, occupy the man, and Mason takes care of the rest.
Marshall, can he get to the edge? And he is taken down right about the 4-yard line, run down by Alan Turner.
Alan Turner's made a couple of really nice defensive plays. That one again, he got him to the edge and forces this third down, but earlier one-on-one underneath with Corey Grant. But here we have a third and short.
Third down and two. Mason lined up behind the fullback, Jake Rush, and he easily goes in again for his second touchdown of the night.
It's all about gap responsibility, and what you're seeing from Trey Mason is runner's patience. He's waiting for the defense to declare where they're going to be. There's the declaration, there's the hole, there's the score.
And Parkey makes it 14-3. Mason has scored a rushing touchdown now in 6 straight games, 13 of his last 16. He's on a roll.
You're not going to get it out of him. And so it's good that he can go study it and take advantage of his football playing down here and get a good degree.
Yeah, the fumble recovery earlier set up their first score. So go for a touchback as we check in with Wendy Nix.
Joe Tess, thank you. It's a Taco Bell studio update. It takes us to Florida and Georgia playing in Jacksonville, and the Gators have made it a game. Here's Tyler Murphy on the carry as he dives into the end zone 14 yards. The Gators had been trailing 23-12, so they go for 2. Murphy to Clay Burton, 23-20. Tess.
Thank you, Wendy. So 23-20 down there in Jacksonville as Arkansas trailing by 11 now back on offense. And they go with the fullback Small. Talked about offensive coordinator Jim Chaney. And I thought it was realistic with what they needed to be today. And so far what they've needed to be is a team that tries a little of everything, Matt.
Yeah, and keep them off balance. And they've done that. Jim Chaney knows that he's got some limitations. But he's going to take some shots. Yeah, they haven't worked. This one was... You know, that day came up short on the onside kick, gave him a short field. They have been able to string together some drives. They need to get 7 instead of 3.
Here's Williams. And Williams charges ahead to the 34-yard line. It'll be 3rd and 1 there. So an onside kick earlier in this quarter. Tried the halfback option pass. Couple end arounds. And they've run wildcat. As Chaney had an interesting quote, we asked him an overall summation of his offense. He said, we're a fragile offense.
Yeah, fragile. And he knows it. But now, right here. Okay, they've been running to the inside. They've been trusting Swanson and those two freshmen. Let's see if they do it again.
They go wildcat again. And Collins was trying to fight for that. But I think he's going to be, well, at least the one official on one side running in was saying short. But now you see the line judge coming in. And I think he may give him the spot. And it is a first down for Arkansas.
They're liking that, the inside run game. They've had success in the inside. They've been able to put together some decent drives here, Tess, but they need to punctuate them with 6 points.
Here's Collins. And Collins was met that time by Kenneth Carter. Gain of about 2 yards there. Well, we got a big one for you Thursday night on ESPN. Pac-12 game of the year, and the Heisman front runner right now, Marcus Mariota, and number 2 Oregon taking on 5th-ranked Stanford. Coverage begins at 7:30 with College Football Live, and then College Football Primetime served by Applebee's at 9 on ESPN, Oregon and Stanford. Second and 8. Here's Allen. He's just 1 for 5 passing. And make it 1 of 6 as Keon Hatcher was the intended target.
Okay, so Auburn has enjoyed tight coverage on the outside. So what they're saying is Ellis Johnson, their defensive coordinator, believes they're not going to get beat on the outside. He likes his coverage. He likes his matchups. That frees up an extra defender to get down into the run game or an extra blitzer or rusher if you're looking at this in 3rd and long. Look at the tight all the way across the board. You got the safety sitting deep. Man all the way around.
Man press coverage, and they go to the inside, and that's a first down as he finds Cowan.
Nicely done by Jim Chaney. So you know your safeties are sitting inside. You get your 2 receivers on the outside, and you just run the slants. You take the inside guy. He's got to come in hard. And then the outside, that should open that whole area up on the outside, and it does. First down.
That's a defense called by Ellis Johnson. Spent a year as the head coach at Southern Miss. And comes to Auburn. Makes the improvement with the scoring defense rankings under Johnson. Inside run by Williams, who's had success. Check in with Wendy again.
Tess, thank you. These two teams have met every year since 1927. Navy and Notre Dame. Terry and Folston, the 1-yard plunge. And the final tally, 38-34, Irish win.
Navy always gives them troubles. Notre Dame needed everything they could get together today to get past the midshipmen.
Big Louie Nix was not playing today. I'm sure that run game, which Navy has, gave his backup some problems.
And take 350 pounds out of the middle of that
exactly.
Notre Dame defense. 2nd and 6 now. Allen gets it complete for a first down. That was a good pass to Hunter Henry, who's been the breakout true freshman tight end, the team's leading receiver.
Hunter Henry is a guy who they've been relying on more and more as the season has gone on. Now he's learning it. He's still picking it up. He's a work in progress and will continue, but he's going to get better and better. Just a freshman.
Had over 100 yards receiving against Texas A&M. He's the only tight end in the SEC with a 100-yard receiving game. Here's Allen again, and he was looking for him on a seam, but he overthrew it.
Can't do that. Said that earlier. When you have an opportunity in games like this, and you're Brandon Allen, you can't waste it. He has the middle of the field wide open.
Got to throw that to the inside.
Yeah, you got to throw it back inside. There's no help inside.
Now Henry put himself in position. Allen didn't deliver. See the time of possession in the plays as Arkansas has had a few long drives, but trailing by 11. Inside run with Collins, and here goes Alex Collins, stiff-arming his way down to the 22. He put that big paw out there against Jermaine Whitehead.
18 yards test. This kid's legit. This kid has outstanding vision, and just he has things you can't really teach, okay? It's just that little bit of burst when you have to. Right there, look at the cut. There's the burst back inside. It's pretty to watch.
Powerful young man, didn't even play high school football until his junior year. Ran into his own man that time and then tried to regain his traction, but couldn't get much going that time as Angelo Blackson was hard to get past.
You could see what Brett Bielema is trying to do here. He's got some pieces of the puzzle. You have the two big freshmen on the inside. You got your running game, your Williams and Collins on the outside. He's got to get a couple more people up front, some big guys, and he needs some speed. And then defensively, he's got to build it. But Tess, you can see what he's trying to do, and the pieces are starting to fall in place.
Get another drive, double-digit plays. Only that field goal to show for it for now. I think that ball may have been touched as Allen was trying to come forward with it, as Kenneth Carter was getting around towards Brandon Allen. Looks like he may have disrupted his throwing motion
there.
Yeah,
it did. Yeah, you're going to watch him on the backside. You're going to see it coming right there.
That was big Kenneth Carter coming to his backside.
He tried to pull the guard, Skipper, from the inside out. That's a tough block. And Carter's coming that hard.
Remember, Skipper's the true freshman. One of two in this offensive line. Third down and 12. They bring four. Allen over the middle, and it'll be first and goal. Razorbacks. Keon Hatcher with the reception.
That's really smartly done by Brandon Allen. He saw the zone. He knew the weakness of the zone was right down the middle. They split the safeties, and Hatcher had to get to the middle of the field. Watch the protection. That's a pickup of 20 on third and 12, and that's money. Test, they've got to get 6 points out of this drive.
Wildcat with Collins again. And that leg drive is going to have him working down towards the three. He was trying to follow his 242-pound fullback, Kiero Small.
They keep trusting that interior. They put a lot on Travis Swanson. We've talked about Skipper a couple times, but there's another freshman on the other side. Denver Kirkland, number 55. They put a lot of that interior.
Third trip into the red zone and four possessions for Arkansas. They got to cash in here. Allen. Small as he tried to extend himself, but was cut down by Chris Davis just outside the 1 yard line. It'll be third and goal.
Good close by Chris Davis Jr. Sets up this third down.
Red zone defense has been solid for Auburn this year.
Wouldn't surprise me if Bielema goes for it on fourth.
Let's see what they get on third. Stacked up was Williams.
Nice.
Fourth and goal now.
That's good, tough defense. I love to see goal line, short yardage defense. That's the last bastion of toughness in all of football.
They're only giving up 20 and a half points a game.
And Auburn showed the toughness right there, Tess. And they are going to go for it on fourth down.
There's Mitchell who had the tackle there. Here's fourth and goal from the one. Williams, not a chance. It was Mitchell again. And Jake Frost as a goal line stand by Auburn. Just shuts down that effort. Three red zone trips for Arkansas.
They got a field goal, an interception, and now this, a turnover on downs. Fourth and goal, denied. Watching August 2014. For more information, you can go to GetSECNetwork.com. Ball's next Saturday will be filled with live football on the SEC Network. Nonstop coverage of undoubtedly the most fascinating conference in college sports. So after the goal line stand, Auburn looking for breathing room now, and Nick Marshall and that offense will provide it with Trey Mason.
Let's go back and watch Ben Bradley. He is the key. Watch this, number 50 on Swanson. He just absolutely blows the middle of the offense up. Now everybody does their job. Frost comes up and makes a hit to the fullback, but Ben Bradley, that was a great play.
And here is Nick Marshall, quarterback for Auburn, who had the right throwing shoulder injury this week. Let's check in with Wendy Nix while we have time.
Joe Tess, thank you. Coming up on the Outback Steakhouse Halftime Report, Florida giving Georgia a run for its money in Jacksonville. Also in the Sunshine State, we'll preview the battle of the unbeatens between Miami and Florida State, and bragging rights on the line. It's a defensive showdown in Michigan. We've got the highlights.
Look forward to it, Wendy. This was Trey Mason there on third and one, as it'll be a first down for the Tigers.
Tess, we didn't have enough time for what Ben Bradley did right there. That's as good as you can do. He just blew up the middle of that offensive line, and by doing that, he essentially moved the line of scrimmage back a yard. That was the key to that whole thing.
Mason again, as he's been getting a lot of work now. 13th carry, tackled by Graylin Mitchell. This is an offense that you think is so complex, but they really only have a few plays. They just do it really, really well, and they window dress everything.
Yeah, that's what they do. They run about maybe four or five plays, but what Trey Mason brings to this thing is some patience. He'll jump inside, make you declare, and then he's back outside and off to the races.
Marshall looking for running room, but he is going to be taken down as a flag comes down. It was Brandon Lewis who was the first to get to him.
As Brandon Lewis was trying to make the tackle, somebody was trying to hold him back, shall we say.
Holding on the offense, number 56. That penalty is declined. Third down.
And that's Avery Young, who has started the last three games.
Well, that sets up a third and long.
47 seconds remain.
They haven't spread out. I wouldn't be surprised to see a draw here to Mason.
Marshall sets up the screen on the other side, and Sammy Coates could not collect it. So 25 seconds left here in the first half.
And so, Tess, what have we seen here through the first half? We've seen an Arkansas offense that certainly is capable enough to move the ball, but they haven't been able to close the deal. And then we've seen an Auburn offense that has been able to string some plays in their run game. And they've taken care of opportunities and turnovers, and they have a 14-3 lead.
Javonte Herndon back near the 43 as Clark into punt. And they're going to put a flag down back at the 5-yard line, as I think one of the Arkansas players may have come in and jumped over the shield.
Which you're not allowed to do.
That's a rule that was put in a few years ago on special teams.
Personal foul, leaping, yep. Number 48. That's a 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
This you can't do, folks. They set up that shield in front of the punter. And Wise Jr. came in leaping over it.
They put this in a couple years ago, and that was to protect the guy from jumping. When he came down, they were landing awkwardly, so they put that in.
Yeah, player safety, always a point of emphasis with the rules committee. And watch here as Wise came in.
See, had he stayed on his feet and tried to run through it and then gotten his arms up, they wouldn't have called anything. But because he left his feet and went vertical, they'll throw that flag.
And that allows Auburn with a first down to simply take a knee here. And as the Arkansas native, Gus Malzahn, has an 11-point lead. And Brett Bielema and Arkansas find themselves in a hole yet again in the midst of a five-game losing stretch and another tough task here with their fifth straight ranked opponent. Let's go down to the field and Maria.
Coach, you have been able to move the ball on offense. What do you believe is keeping you out of the end zone right now?
Well, we just obviously got to take advantage in the red zone. We got to come up with touchdowns, not field goals. We had a couple silly penalties there that obviously take away from some special plays we're trying to create.
Well, you've called some trick plays, a fourth down call. What's the thinking behind those calls?
Well, we're just tired of losing. We're going to do anything we can to win. We're going to need some help. Got to get a break or two and obviously capitalize on our advantage.
All right, thanks, Coach.
Honest answer, right, Maria? They're tired of losing. They had those three red zone trips. They only came away with 3 points. Let's join Wendy Nix, Todd McShay, and Robert Smith back in the studio for the Outback Steakhouse halftime report.
Joe Tess, thank you.
Three lead against Arkansas. Joe Tessitore, Matt Millen with you. It's an interesting first half when you look at some of the sustained long drives by Arkansas. They had 75 more total yards. They had more plays. They don't have more points, though, and it's because of some miscues and some turnovers early and then down there at the goal line. Things going against them, and right from the start, they had an injury to their quarterback, Brandon Allen, when they came out earlier, and Allen would leave, and that would bring A.J. Derby into the game, and then came the turnovers, Matt.
Yeah, a little bit of a slide from there. First the one batted up in the air, and it's a pick. Now, they were able to dodge that one, but this one gave a short field, and they couldn't overcome it. And then when they had their opportunities down inside the 1 yard line, they came away with nothing. This is a team right now that has enough pieces of the puzzle to be able to compete with the number 11 team in the country. But you can't beat yourself with turnovers. And Arkansas has proved that they don't really need much time or many plays to be able to hang points on.
Time of possession means nothing to Auburn and Gus Malzahn. That's the way they operate. But those three red zone trips for Arkansas, field goal, an interception, and a turnover on downs with the goal line stand. So Zach Cocker will kick away. And this takes a bounce, and this will draw a penalty flag as it went out of bounds before it reached the end zone.
Another one of those things.
Giving free yardage away. Let's check in with Maria.
Well, Gus Malzahn says that right now, his offense is just having time taken away from him. His defense is struggling so much to get off the field. And he says the opportunities are there. He'd like to see more aggression from his defensive line. Also, he says offensively, he feels like his team can run the ball a little bit better. So look for that in the second half, guys.
Yeah, they've been running the ball so well this season, the Auburn offense. Fifth best rushing team in the country. Number one running team in the SEC. Trey Mason, a big part of what they do week in and week out. And he had 13 carries for 93 yards and two touchdowns in the first half here in Fayetteville. Marshall trying to find a crevice there in that defensive line.
The first half, Tess, when you talk about Auburn, you're talking about Trey Mason. Trey Mason was their workhorse. Trey Mason's a guy. 13 rushes, 93 yards in the first half alone. He's been a one-man wrecking crew. And so to counter him right now, I think you have to load this box up, which they're dropping a safety down now.
Second and seven as they get it to Lewis, and a first down for Auburn as Lewis gets out to the 49-yard line, brought down by Eric Bennett.
One of the things that cripples Arkansas's defensive coordinator, Chris Ash, is they don't have cover guys, so they can't really lock guys up. They've got to play a lot of zone behind them. And in every zone, there are holes.
Another first down run by Trey Mason as Washington finally corralled him, but he gets just beyond the 45-yard line, close to the 44. Second and three now. Marshall quickly getting it to Lewis again. And Ricardo Lewis turning the corner. Another Auburn first down.
When you're going to, this is a typical Gus Malzahn offensive play call. If you're going to sit in a zone and you're going to sit off that far, then I'm going to throw it to the open guy. I mean, just let him run with it.
You see the cushion again here. And here's Mason bouncing it to the outside and then running over Tevin Mitchell. You think about how effective and efficient Auburn consistently is on offense. Yards by down on first down, they are consistently setting themselves up this year for second and three. I mean, look at these numbers, over 7 yards, first, second, third down. They will gash it. And here's Jeremy Johnson all of a sudden into the game, and as he did last week, comes right in and passes the ball with success. The freshman quarterback coming in for Nick Marshall. This is a young man from Montgomery, Alabama, who coaches just rave about. Mr. Football and Mr. Basketball in Alabama. Huge recruit who is the future of the program. Trey Mason straight up the middle as he gets inside the 10.
Well, Johnson's got himself a big arm, and they love the way he throws the football. And if you add that piece of the puzzle, a consistent throwing arm to this piece of the puzzle, this offense, they're going to be really tough to stop.
Second and three, and that time he was stacked up. That was Braylon Mitchell finding Mason. So it'll be third down as Johnson comes out and Nick Marshall comes in. So mid-series, they swap out Marshall and Johnson, and now here on third down, they go with the more experienced Nick Marshall.
And the crowd senses a little bit here, so you got a little bit of life, which has been a dead first half for this in this crowd.
Mason remains the back. And he will have a first and goal for Auburn. Another 100-yard rushing game for Trey Mason, his fourth this year. Two touchdowns already. He took over that game late against Texas A&M, carried them to the win. He is a machine over the course of this season. That time he was stacked up as DeMarcus Hodge was able to fill that gap.
They're not very varied in their running game. They're just very efficient. You spoke about it earlier. They'll give you different window dressings on the outside. By that, I mean they might give you different formations, different personnel groups on the outside. But inevitably, if you look from tackle to tackle and in the backfield, it's the same look.
And keep it simple, but they do it well. Second and goal. Just like that, Trey Mason. His third touchdown of the night. As Auburn comes out here in this first possession of the second half and goes right down the field.
So those of you who haven't seen this Auburn team, you're sitting at home now and you're watching us and you're sitting there saying, how the heck can this be the same team as a year ago? How can it be this good this year and efficient and not be as good a year ago? In fact, not very good at all.
Because of that guy and this guy who's come back home to Arkansas with the 11th ranked team in the country. That is the best turnaround team in college football. 1-7 last year through 8 games, 7-1. And with a 21-3 lead, they're looking for win number 8.
Watch, they're going to take this as a stunt. They're going to take DeMarcus Hodge. They're going to run him inside. When that happens, you're the linebacker, Lake. You have to attack this because they're going to pull a guard and come back up inside. And then the other backer has to hit this hard. It's all about gap control again. If you hesitate, you lose. They hesitated, They're six.
Trey Mason, 120 yards and three touchdowns for Auburn. What does Arkansas have for an answer? Stick around. We'll find out together. On ESPN News, Cowboys have had those post-game losses. Detroit, the game against Denver early in the season against Kansas City. Of course, the owner of the Cowboys, a former Arkansas Razorback, big supporter of this program. Arkansas trails by 18. Jonathan Williams, just what they needed. Good start to this drive as he keeps his balance. What an effort by Williams.
Tess, I want to show you near the end of this drive, a run, as he's on the sideline, he sees the safety coming rather than going out of bounds. This is how you finish a run. Watch this, right at the end. He sees this right there. He goes and attacks him. Instead of being attacked, he went on the offensive, kind of a little bit of Walter Payton-ish. I like that.
Gave a shoulder to Ryan Smith, went for 26 yards. So a first down in Auburn territory. Play action now. Brandon Allen. He's going to launch it downfield. And the diving effort goes incomplete that time as he was looking for Jeremy Sprinkle.
He had Sprinkle all alone. When you have a guy wide open like that, you got to throw it at him. He tried to, but he does not get his feet completely under. Watch this on the outside. He doesn't really set his feet. Therefore, he doesn't get everything into the ball, and it just falls short.
That was Chris Davis, who was trying to catch up to big number 83. He went down at the end of the play. As we got a medical timeout here as the training staff is out to tend to Chris Davis, who is considered Auburn's best cover corner. We'll take a short break and come right back. Believe it, you deep fry pretty much cardboard and I'm right there with you. Here's second and 10. As they go with Collins that time. So moments ago we saw Chris Davis come off the field for Auburn. He leaves as their leading tackler, seven tackles up until that point.
And their best cover guy.
Third and six now for Arkansas. Desperate to close the gap here in the second half against that consistent running game of Auburn. Brandon Allen has time, crossing route. They get the first down with Henry. This is a good-looking true freshman as the flag comes down at the 38-yard line. We'll check on that.
Well-delivered ball, but a nice catch. He just stabbed that thing with one hand out of the air.
Oh, I think there was a pick here.
Pass interference on the offense, number 89. That's a 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay, third down.
It's a crossing route, and it's going to be a rub or a pick. You can see right here. See that? And that's blatant. That's blatant. That's why they call it. That's Mitchell Lowen. And Lowen's got to be a little bit more discreet than that. It's all, yeah, there are picks run all the time, but you can't go drill a guy with your face. Now you sit up third and forever.
Third down and 21. And they will just go on the ground with Collins. And Collins is taken down right around midfield that time by Jonathan Mincy. So that penalty put him in a tough spot.
I test. This Razorback team is close. They're not that far. They have some good players. They've been beaten themselves. I mean, I don't want to take any away from Auburn. Auburn is proving what they are. But Arkansas is not that far off.
239 total yards for Arkansas at Auburn's 189. But some of these drives have come up short, or they've turned it over, or penalties getting the best of them like it happened right there. So Sam Irwin Hill on to punt. Juan Bray's going to let it bounce. And Irwin Hill does his job on special teams. Talk more about Gus Malzahn and his ties to this state when we come.
He's his coordinator.
Auburn, you know about last year where there was a meltdown in Arkansas State. He was the head coach, won the Sun Belt Championship, now just 3-4 this season. As they say, steady with Trey Mason, does Auburn. Trey Mason's got plenty of work. 21st carry of the night, 122 yards now for the junior running back.
And we're not seeing any trick plays. We're not seeing anything different. We're seeing the same thing. Gus Malzahn believes in that. He believes in an offense that executes, and they continue to do just that.
Second and eight. Nick Marshall's only thrown the ball five times. Here he is on the ground, and he was met by the 345-pound Hodge and Trey Flowers, the 265-pound defensive end.
Ooh, that's a nice stop right there, DeMarcus Hodge. Let's see if he can conjure something up here on third down. The Razorbacks need themselves a stop to get back in this thing.
Not a lot is asked of Nick Marshall tonight throwing the ball. Remember, he hurt his right throwing shoulder in the win against Florida Atlantic. Third and seven, he's going to launch it downfield. And who comes up with it but Sammy Coates, who leads the nation in yards per reception. And you can add more to that. Sammy Coates, 88-yard touchdown.
The coverage was all over him, but Coach came up with the ball. Mitchell misplayed it, and another big play later, and Coach has himself six quick. Watch his ball's underthrown. Mitchell misplays it. He doesn't locate it in time. Coach does, and the rest is history.
And Cody Parkey now with 89 straight PATs. You think they're all about the run. And then all of a sudden, Sammy Coates just flat out outruns everybody. Nick Marshall, seventh passing touchdown of the year for the junior. 28-3 Auburn.
Well, Chris Ash, their defensive coordinator, did not want to get in this position up top. The safety, if it's cover two, should be back here. He does not get there. And so it turns into a one-on-one on the outside, and Mitchell just gets run by. Now, when the receiver looks as a defender, you turn and look, but you got to choke it down. Play the ball. He did not do it. Coach did a fantastic job, and it's six quick.
And he was having a quiet night of two catches for 14 yards before that. And look what he's done, the receptions this season. Now three over 60 yards, 11 over 30 yards, came in leading the nation at 25 and a half yards per catch. And he's up in that a bit here. As this is Marshall from the end zone. And past the kicker he goes, Corliss Marshall. A stiff arm inside the 15. Nice way to respond by Arkansas. See Jonathan Mincy, Auburn's starting cornerback, slow to get up at the end of that.
And Mincy saved the touchdown. He took a great angle on that one and was able to force him out of bounds, or this is six quick. You're going to watch it open up to the on the left side of your screen. This is Corliss Marshall, number 33. Now he's going to hit this right there. Beach the kicker. Now you've got to get an angle if you're a defender. Now look at that. That's a fantastic angle. That is as good as it gets. And it works, gets him out of bounds, comes up a little lame, but he saved a touchdown. The thing that's so impressive about that is, if you've never played the game, on every step that you're running, you are adjusting to the speed and the position of the guy who has the ball and is trying to score. And so every step you take, Mincy had to make another choice. That's fantastic job, Mincy.
Starting cornerback out there on kick coverage, And he came up with the angle and the speed and the effort as the ball is placed on the 13-yard line.
Sometimes, Tess, it doesn't matter how many good calculations you make. Their speed is just too amazing. And I'm watching Auburn here, and I'm thinking back to a guy who was just off the charts. His name was Vincent Bo Jackson.
He was a pretty good one, wasn't he?
And Bo Jackson used to routinely outrun any angle you could put on the field.
Angles didn't matter for Bo.
No, they didn't. My old teammate, boy, he was a fun one to play with.
So here's another red zone trip for Arkansas. All they have is a field goal to show for it. They're going to pass again. And this ball is incomplete as he was looking for Hunter Henry. And that's the second halfback option pass we've seen from Arkansas tonight.
And so if you're sitting at home, you go, why are they having the running back throw? Well, the answer is this. They've been running so well that by getting him to the edge, you can get a commitment from those defenders up front. And then you can dump it over the top just a little bit too long.
Brandon Allen. And that was well thrown to Keon Hatcher. Touchdown, Arkansas.
That's a nice throw. Allen threw it to his spot. I thought Hatcher wasn't going to be able to get there. He kind of stumbled right at the start of his route.
Put enough air underneath it, and Hatcher ran underneath it. Auburn has the big play on one end as Sammy Coates went for 88 yards, but then Corliss Marshall had the 87-yard return to set up this.
They're man-to-man on the outside. Watch Hatcher. The first thing he's got to do, he's got to get that defender inside. See how he stumbled a little bit? But he was able to get the defender to the inside of his hip. And that gave you leverage to the outside. There's no one else out there, so the quarterback has an area to throw to. Brandon Allen was happy with that throw, and he should be.
Allen left the game injured in the first quarter, came back. And now the ninth touchdown pass for Brandon Allen this year. Got an NFC North showdown at Lambeau Millen come Monday night on ESPN. Brandon Marshall and the Bears going up against Aaron Rodgers and the Packers. Monday night countdown will get you started at 6:30 Eastern, and then Bears-Packers, classic rivalry, 8:25 on ESPN. How you see that one?
Lombardi versus Halas. It's going to be the Green Bay Packers are getting better. Their running game is coming along. Lacy, you know who they remind me of, Tess? They remind me of an old John Brockington and MacArthur Lane. They've got that same kind of look. Just a lot of power. Lane would give you a little bit of extra. That's what Starks does. They're fun to watch right now. They're getting better, and they're getting healthier.
Arkansas hopes to keep getting better as the year continues and somehow pull themselves out of this slide. Five-game losing streak. Facing their fifth straight ranked opponent here tonight against Auburn. As Mason will just take a knee, and we get to visit with Wendy Nix.
Joe Tess, thank you. It's a Dr. Pepper 10 conference update. Missouri trying to bounce back after a tough loss to South Carolina in triple overtime last week. Matty Mock, Gabriel Green Beckham, touchdown Mizzou. This game now 7-0. Mizzou over Tennessee over on ESPN. Tess?
Now, Wendy, Matt and I spent the whole week answering questions about the double overtime shocker last week when South Carolina came back against Missouri. And this SEC East, in a couple weeks there, everybody talking about, yeah, Missouri's going to lock this thing up. They got the cushion. They got the tiebreak. Hold on, folks. South Carolina, they won again today. You saw what happened with Georgia. There's a lot of football to be played in this great conference. And this is Corey Grant. And he was stacked up. It was Eric Bennett, the first to get to him, and Brooks Ellis also joined in.
Bennett's the guy who made the play. See what they did? They triangulated it. You got to be outside, inside, and one down the middle. And Bennett did a nice job from the safety spot to set up the second down.
Mason, nowhere to go that time. Allen Turner on the tackle.
Yes, Allen Turner's a what?
The safety. Yeah. They bring him down to the box.
And look exactly where he made that tackle, down to the line of scrimmage to set up this third and long. So they're rolling the dice a little bit.
They really forced him, Matt.
You have to.
Circumstances here and what Auburn's consistently done.
Now they're going to be third and long. They're going to stay in the zone. They have to make a tackle in front of those yard markers.
Third and eight. Remember, Marshall took a shot last time and connected with Coates for an 88-yard touchdown. Coates is on the bottom of your screen, the speedster for the Tigers. Let's see if he looks his way here. Pressure coming. Can he escape it? No. He is taken down that time. That was Chris Smith, number three in the SEC in sacks, and he gets a timely one there.
And because Chris Smith benefited from a little extra time down the field, the coverage, he was looking to the right side. But watch Smith with a great get-off. And then he's able to just complete that thing by hanging on and gets a sack. Decent coverage down the field, and Smith benefited. You can't do that. That's a big no-no in the kicking game. There are three no-nos in the kicking game. Don't be offsides, don't rough the kicker, and do not let the ball hit the ground. You can't do that.
Goes for a 53-yard punt. Gus Malzahn and Brett Bielema, they've had an interesting early relationship as SEC head coaches. Let's take you back to SEC media days this summer.
There's coaches in this league that have criticized hurry-up offenses as being unsafe.
Well, you know, when I first heard that, to be honest with you, I thought it was a joke.
He thought it was a joke? I'm not a comedian.
You know, that's like saying the defense shouldn't blitz after a first down because they're a little fatigued.
You cannot tell me that a player after play five is the same player that he is after play 15.
We need to look at the guys on defense that are faking injuries to slow down these pace teams.
In addition to not being a comedian, I'm not an actor. I can't tell you how to fake a kid to fake an injury. I do think I'm funny at times, though. I will say that.
Now they meet up here. As that hurry up, spread up tempo run attack of Auburn has an 18-point lead. Second and 10 after the incompletion on first down. Brandon Allen out of the gun. As Alex Collins, he took a little stutter step there and then tried to find a hole, but nothing doing as he's stacked up at the line of scrimmage. And then I'm going to show you what it was like this summer with Malzahn and Bielema in front of 1,200 credentialed media, but here's what it was like pregame as both guys getting together, sharing a nice exchange and a couple laughs. And this past week, there was Bielema filing a complaint with the SEC offices of a claim of Auburn leaving plays off the coach's film, but they had a lot of nice things to say about each other when the media press come middle of the week. Third and 10. Here's the slant. And it's a first down to Keon Hatcher. Hatcher's had some good moments.
And so has Brandon Allen. In that time, he had nice protection. He stood right in there. Remember, in the second quarter, he hit the outside guy for a big first down. This time, he hits the inside of those slant receivers.
Arkansas, 8 for 12 on third downs, as we're going to see the direct snap again here on first down. And Collins with blockers in front. And Collins will have another first down for Arkansas. That was Travis Swanson and a true freshman Kirkland out in front of Collins.
That's one of the things that Swanson does really well, and I think that's why his game translates to the next level so well. He has great movement. He's over 300 pounds. You can pull him. He works good to second level, which means gets to the linebackers well. And anytime you have that kind of versatility, there's a place for you at the next level.
Travis Swanson, number 64, the center for Arkansas. Here's Collins again. That stiff arm rides him to the 46-yard line, tackled by Therese.
That's really good by Therese. Therese got himself a nice tackle from the inside out. He also got himself a nice handful of dreads right there.
And it's a convenient handle for tackling.
I'm always wondering, you know, the NCAA has been talking about that stuff with the hair, but they're allowing it to happen to stay outside the helmet. And if that's the case, then it's free game, man. I'm giving it a good yank.
All freshmen in rushing in the country. Allen looking to throw back against the grain. And that ball is intercepted as a flag is down, and Chris Frost came up with it. Let's see what the call is here. Anthony Swain was also in on coverage, and you see Allen signaling against Auburn.
It's the old throwback. They have opened the playbook wide open here tonight in Arkansas. They've tried everything.
Matt Leffler didn't turn his mic on there, but pass interference against Auburn is the call.
Yeah, that's the right call. Yeah, it's Hunter waiting there, and then Swain loses sight of the ball and plays the man instead of the ball.
Chris Malzahn looking for an explanation. First down at the 31. Play action. Allen again. He wants it all to the end zone. There's a lot of contact, and two more flags come in as Ryan White was tangled up with Javonte Herndon.
Herndon, they're trying to throw that back shoulder because White was right in his face, so they throw it behind him, and Herndon tries to work back to it.
Once again, some mic issues with referee Matt Leffler.
Yeah, watch on the backside. You're going to see it. He's going to try to work back. There's a hand in the chest. I'm not too sure about that one.
And the ball being thrown where it was back to the inside actually
White has
caused
position.
For it to be more contact because then Herndon has to try to gain position to the inside. First down at the 16. Williams. Good block for Williams as he drives those legs inside the 10. Arkansas moving again.
I like this kid. Jonathan Williams, he's got something to him. He's got some good power. He doesn't go down with one tackler. He's going forward. Generally, I mean, you rarely see him go backwards. Usually you'll see that scrum pile keep moving forward. He's fun to watch.
Second and three. Williams, maybe a gain of one that time as he was met by Chris Frost and Jermaine Whitehead.
We've mentioned Chris Frost a few times tonight. He's played himself a pretty good game. Kid who's not a real thick guy. But he's a good reader test. He does a really good job. You'll always find him around the ball. Those guys, some guys just have that ability. They're kind of ball magnets. He's one of them.
Third and three. Well, they go to the true freshman, Alex Collins. Allen the pass.
Magic.
Off the fingertips of the usually reliable Hunter Henry.
Yeah, he had that right away. He saw it right away. Henry's got to make that catch. It was a little high, but if you're supposed to be all that, you make that catch. He sees it right away. Yeah, that's, you got to make that.
Watch this formation they're bringing out as they go with the diamond set swinging gate. Will they snap here? Yes, they do. Little trick play here, and they get the first down out of it. It'll be first and goal, Arkansas. Austin Tate, you know, after a week of controversy about what was left off the coach's tape, and it was a swinging gate extra point that was left off, Well, look what Brett Bielema pulls out.
Yeah, you know what he did? He just out Malzahned Malzahn. That's Brian Beener, Boehner. Now, why is he eligible? Because he was the end man at the line of scrimmage. They can go out for a pass. And I'm sorry, 87 is Tate. 87 is Tate. And that's a fantastic job. Jim Chaney's been around the block a time or two. And so he's the offensive coordinator for Arkansas. He's done everything you can do.
I wonder if Bielema is out there complaining to the refs with his injury in the end zone about stalling on momentum.
Yeah, wanted to go
just
with the hurry
yet up. Another subplot. That's to what has happened between these two staffs.
That's Swain, the backer, who earlier had that interference call, but they're checking his knee.
Well, you be the judge. Watch number 43. He's just standing there, Matt. Fine as could be, then he just drops.
Guilty as charged, my friend.
I mean, he's standing around looking over at the coaching staff, and then all of a sudden, he drops.
That's a legitimate complaint right there for Brett Bielema. That one's...
And then watch Brett Bielema's reaction.
He said, "Are you kidding me?"
I think the SEC office is going to be a little busy this week after this game.
They'll see that one. Good test.
Hey, it's an 18-point game. But Pig Suey's got a little bit of momentum. One would assume that he would be okay based on what we saw in the last play as a little momentum stalling moment as Arkansas had the fake field goal. Now they have first and goal. And they go with the fullback right into the end zone. Kiero Small. A name that belies him in every way as he's been big for this program. And Arkansas is closing right back into this.
They may just have ignited a little bit of Suey Pig down here. Remember last time they were down there, they stuffed them at the line of scrimmage. Now they go to the edge for the score with Small.
They trailed 28-3 with 6:39 left in the third quarter. And the irony of what is potentially, to our eyes, possibly faking an injury to stall on pace. Remember Gus Malzahn at SEC Media Days just this summer on the other side of this.
We need to look at the guys on defense that are faking injuries to slow down these pace teams.
Well, Matt, this was moments ago.
And that was just the tip of it. What you don't see, this is the end of the play. Now you're going to watch him right down here, okay? He's on the ground. Yeah. He's going to get up. He knows the play was made. Now look his eyes. His eyes are back
to the
sideline.
Well, look at the way he's walking.
He's walking
perfectly fine.
But his eyes are back saying, okay, what are we doing? And now he gets the signal or whatever they tell him. And now watch. Stand a little bit.
He stands perfectly fine. Has his hands on his hips.
Okay.
And then just goes down.
Yeah.
And then Brett Bielema says, now, wait a minute. He's saying other teams? Look at what they just did. This game is 28-17. Number 11 Auburn was having their way with Arkansas, and Arkansas was coming up short time and time again on some of those red zone trips. Then all of a sudden, getting a little momentum. Seven-point game, Wendy Nix. Could be interesting. Let's check in with the studio.
Joe Tass, what's also interesting, Florida State's first possession facing Miami on ABC, 13 plays, 72 yards later, and the Seminoles are on the board thanks to Devontae Freeman. And on ESPN, Missouri trying to bounce back from the loss to South Carolina, leading Tennessee 17-3.
So Mizzou up a couple of scores. Remember, they had that big lead that went away against South Carolina last week. And will Auburn have a big lead that they find it difficult to hang on to? This Arkansas defense needs to play up now. Here's Nick Marshall. And Marshall goes right around the would-be tackle.
Fumble.
He fumbles the ball. Arkansas may have this.
Nope.
No, Auburn comes up with it. Boy, there were a couple defensive backs right in the mix there. At the end of that play, it was Eric Bennett who forced the fumble. An intense moment as Nick Marshall had a great run, but then lost the ball at the end. And I think it may have been Marshall as the ball came back towards him.
Oh.
I mean, look at the Arkansas defensive back trying to bring the ball back in. And I think it was Marshall who was able to get his own fumble. And now Trey Mason. And just like that, and this is how fast Auburn can work with this magnificent up-tempo run-based spread. They're down to the 38-yard line. You blink and they're on your side of the field.
Well, Nick Marshall did a great job on that option because he had Eric Bennett flat-footed and got the corner just like that.
And another first down for the Tigers. Trey Mason continues to have a big night. 136 yards and three touchdowns for the junior running back. He's playing as well as he ever has. He's played well this year against some of the better teams. Good efforts against LSU, Ole Miss, Texas A&M. That was a signature win to spark this great turnaround season for the Tigers. Takes advantage of good blocking on the right side of the line.
Great test. There's only two plays they're giving it to him on. One's just a straight dive from his side, and the other one is they run the option to the other side, and they either hand it to him or Marshall takes it out and goes up the edge, and that's it. Other than that, they've been running the same thing for the left or right side all night long.
And keep getting 7-8 yards on these dive plays and sets up such manageable down and distance like this, second and two.
There it is
again. Here it is again. And this time he's going to be about a yard short as DeMarcus Hodge, big run stopper for Arkansas, able to get the job done.
You know, I like what Gus Malzahn, what he's basically saying is, look, if you can't stop it, I'm going to keep on running it until you do. And then I'm going to run it again just to make sure you can stop it.
I think he's got a great sense of what their identity is and maximizing the output of it. And that has been the running game. Best rushing team in the SEC, fifth best in the country. Third and one. Here's Marshall. And you see how good he can be as they will have a first down just inside the 12-yard line. And all that Arkansas momentum and all that roar that this crowd was making, this drive silencing that. Braylon Mitchell with the tackle on Mason.
When you're defending this Auburn team, you have to have assignment football. And so you have to be able to maintain your gaps inside, and whoever has the quarterback on the edge, you have to get to him every time. You can't fight on the fakes inside. You have to attack the mesh point all the time. You have to be aggressive and stay on your assignment.
Mason gets it down to the 6-yard line, tackled by Brooks Ellis, the true freshman middle linebacker.
They've struggled at the linebacker spots, has this Arkansas defense.
They're not very athletic there. This is the first time that Ellis is getting a start inside tonight. They hope he can be the answer for the future. But their down line, not bad. The backers, they've not been very good this year.
Third and four. You get a first down just inside the 2-yard line. Play clock is under four. Hits zeros.
Delay game on the offense. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
And Marshall was checking over with the coaching staff as that play clock was coming down.
They got a timeout, Auburn.
First short stop, timeout.
Now they're going to give Auburn the timeout. And we will take a short break. 17 here in the fourth quarter, number 11 team in the country. The play clock was coming down. They marked off the penalty, then the timeout.
Well, Gus Malzahn thought that he called the timeout before the penalty, but they didn't give it to him.
So it makes it third and nine. Ray Mason on third and nine. Diving for the end zone. Touchdown, Auburn.
That was a nice run.
Boy, he's had a great night. Four touchdowns for Mason.
Yeah, I like the design of that play. And they took Jay Prosh, their fullback, and moved him over that, shifted the backers, and then they ran back to the outside where there were lesser defenders. And with Mason's speed, he got the six.
Markey puts it through. 13 rushing touchdowns on the year now for Mason. His fourth tonight. Tremendous effort getting to the edge and skying, diving into the end zone. Dixon Street here in Fayetteville, Arkansas. We're over at Razorback Stadium. Trey Mason of Auburn's been the star of the night.
Yeah, defense is all about numbers. Look at this. You only have four guys. These three in here and him, okay? Now, what happens, as soon as they motion over, you get a slight shift. Now they hand the ball, stop it right there. Look at the backers. They jump to this side. Now that evens up everything. Here's the guy he's got to beat. If he can beat him, you have a blocker to the outside, and he does it. That's really well executed and a nice concept that Auburn is able to take care of.
Remember, Corliss Marshall had an 87-yard return earlier. This, he just takes a knee on. Let's check in with Wendy.
Tess, thank you. We check on Missouri and Tennessee. This game nearing the half on ESPN. Matty Malk to Marcus Lucas. The 40-yard connection puts Mizzou up 24-3. That's how we stand as we enter the break. And Johnny Manziel and Texas A&M set to take on UTEP. That game coming up right here on ESPN2, set to kick off at 9:15 Eastern.
Good bounce back for Matty Malk and the Tigers. And Gus Malzahn won 83 consecutive games when they score over 30 points. 35-17, our score here. Williams has nowhere to go.
You know, Tess, Gus Malzahn's having a fantastic year with the turnaround here at Auburn, but Gary Pinkel has quietly put together himself a pretty darn good team and a very good defense, and I don't think anybody saw it coming.
Missouri just that one blemish, giving up the 17-point lead last week, the loss in double overtime to South Carolina, as this is complete to Herndon.
Now Arkansas goes with the hurry up.
Allen steps up, he's going to tuck it, and he slides for a first down. What a turnaround you mentioned with Gus Malzahn. This is the best turnaround anybody's having in college football. Through eight games last year, they were just 1-7, now 7-1, number 11 team in the country. Of course, Baylor sitting there at 7-0. Allen's past the line of scrimmage as he scoots out of bounds. Let's go down to the field to Maria for a report.
Yeah, about that Auburn turnaround, guys. You know, players, they actually say that a sense of urgency was brought when Gus Malzahn came back and just really setting out the guidelines, knowing what the expectations are. It was kind of a breath of fresh air. And there were times in games when they felt like the team was throwing in the towel last year, even in the first half. And the attitude has completely changed with the new coaching.
No doubt about it. Second and eight here with Allen as a wobbly ball thrown out of bounds. And to Maria's point, you know, last year was almost an institutional and cultural around the program meltdown with what happened with Gene Chizik before he was released of his duties. And Malzahn coming back here, many of the players on this team he recruited.
Yeah, absolutely. For this offense and to play this particular way. And I can't tell you how difficult it is to change an attitude within an organization. That is really, really tough to do. But he's been able to get it done.
Third and eight now. Allen, here's the slant, and that goes for about 7 yards to Herndon.
He throws that ball pretty well. He's had that, he's been on that thing all night long. We'll set up this short yardage, fourth and one, see if they stay with it. I think they have to. And they are. See if they don't get Williams on an edge. They're going to get locked up man-to-man if they are outside.
Here's fourth and one. And crossing midfield is Herndon again.
Another flag.
Flag comes down.
In the middle of the field.
Right there at the 48-yard line, so we will check on that.
Pass interference on the offense, number 84. That's a 15-yard penalty. Replay, fourth down.
Now set them back on what was a fourth and one. They got Hunter Henry, I think, clearing some space there.
See, he's right down here. That's a pretty weak call.
And negated a 23-yard gain and a first down. Sam Irwin Hill steps on the punt. And the Australian boots, a good one, fielded by Chris Davis at about the 23. Davis weaves his way out to the 34. 18 points in Alabama this coming Saturday.
That's another good coaching job going on down there at Miami with Al Golden, his staff.
He's a tremendous coach and everything they've had to get through in recent years. More work for Trey Mason for three. Here's Wendy Nix.
Joe Tess, thank you. When last we checked, Florida State, Miami trailing 7-0. Here's Miami with the answer. And they've tied it up 7-0 in Tallahassee. Texas A&M, 14 straight against unranked opponents. Mike Evans and company getting set to host UTEP right here on ESPN2 next.
Mike Evans just having a statistically superb year. Of course, Johnny Manziel, probably the most thrilling, exciting player in all of college football. He'll be coming up a little later. But Stephen Morris get Miami tied up with Florida State there.
And just still, gain of two. Maybe the best player in college football. There's a lot of debate, as
right.
I know your Heismanology. I might have to take that course.
We teach it often. Take the poll every week of the official voters at ESPN. Put in their ballots as if they're voting for the award there week by week. And it's a top-heavy campaign this year with Mariota and Jameis Winston and Johnny Manziel.
Mariota's really fun to watch, too. And he's gotten a lot better as the season even's gone on. Big game Thursday night, as there is a big down right here on third.
Third and six for Auburn. And Mason can only manage a yard that time. Waylon Mitchell with the tackle. You brought it up, so here it is. Number two, number five, Oregon visiting Stanford Thursday at 9 o'clock. College Football Live will get the night start at 7:30, and then College Football Primetime served by Applebee's Thursday at 9 on ESPN. And these are the results of our Heismanology poll, and we use the same exact formula as the way they calculate the Heisman Trophy. And Mariota is maintaining first. Winston gets a lot of support for first and second. He's in second. Manziel, people are split on. You got folks that still think of him as the number one guy, and then most who give him third place support on those ballots. And Herndon calls for the fair catch. Just over 5 minutes to go here in Fayetteville. To date, Allstate has contributed more than $3.2 million in those scholarship monies. Arkansas had some spirited moments here in the second half. 5:03 to play. Trailing number 11 by 18. And Brandon Allen connects for a completion to Herndon, who was covered by Chris Davis.
Test, this Arkansas football team's not far away. I mean, I know their record doesn't say it. They're looks like they're going to lose their sixth straight. But they've got some good players. And if they don't beat themselves, they can be competitive with anybody.
Well, they can be very competitive with Alex Collins' future. He's brought down there, but he's a heck of a good-looking true freshman. Let's check in with Maria.
You guys have an injury update on linebacker Anthony Swain. When he came off to the sideline, he rode the bike at first, and they put him back on the table and put a knee brace on that right knee. And then he ran back and forth to see if he could run on it. Looked like he was able to put pressure on it, definitely able to run with speed. And, of course, he has not been back in the game.
I think there'll be some people taking a look at what happened to Anthony Swain with his injury earlier tonight. They're 2nd and 13. Show you one more time what happened earlier when Arkansas was trying to go with some pace and tempo and was gaining momentum. There's Swain standing around after he walked to that position and mysteriously just went down, just fell down to the turf there, Matt.
Yeah, I thought Brett Bielema, the first time he looked at it, he said, "Are you kidding me?" I'm sorry, I shouldn't be laughing because I hope the kid is fine.
No, there is an injury now for Auburn at the end of that play, and this is a guy who they think could be a superstar. That's Carl Lawson, their freshman defensive end, who was a huge recruit. I mean, this was a guy that everybody in the country wanted in on, a freak of an athlete, and coaches feel that he could be one of the most dominant players if he stays the course that he's on. It's good to see Lawson running off the field. Watch 55 on the end.
Working off the edge. He just got what you call chipped. And he's got to be aware of that because Alex Collins saw him, saw the chest. That's what you do. You take a piece of that chest out, he'll be fine. Alpharetta, that's where...
He was a huge score for Gus Malzahn right out of the gate.
Oh, that's funny.
To remind you about what's coming your way in August 2014. A new network for the most storied conference in college sports, the SEC Network. And for more information, you can go to getsecnetwork.com. You will have plenty of Saturdays filled with SEC football on the SEC Network, original programming, and the rest. See one of the officials being tended to. That is referee Matt Leffler, who heads up this crew. Ken Williamson is the alternate referee who's here. And Williamson, a well-experienced guy. In fact, he was the referee heading up the game officials last week in that classic South Carolina-Missouri double overtime game. So give me that hat. And Ken Williamson, that's exactly why you have the alternate around. So they hand him the hat, takes the whistle. We hope Matt Loeffler is okay, as the Arkansas trainers are going to help out the veteran SEC referee. Here's third and 13 after the delay with the player injury, and then the officials having to deal with an injury. And Brandon Allen is taken down by D. Ford. What a season D. Ford continues to have. Maria telling us that Matt Loeffler was a referee dealing with a calf injury there. Wish him the best as Arkansas will be punting away again. Irwin's kick bounces back towards midfield. Gives us a chance to check in with Wendy Nix in the studio.
Tess, thank you. Just a reminder, coming up in about 10 minutes, Johnny Manziel and number 12 Texas A&M set to host UTEP, who enters this game on a five-game losing streak. Kickoff expected just about 9:15 here on ESPN2.
Always fun to see what Johnny Football will pull off. This Auburn team could really have something special in this month of November, especially with Mason running the way he is, 168 yards and four touchdowns on the night.
Well, they got a couple other guys in that backfield who are pretty darn good, and right here is one of them.
Cameron Artis Payne, Jr., who five rushing touchdowns coming in. And, you know, would you ever think that we'd be talking about Auburn the way we are at this point of the season? But this turnaround by Gus Malzahn and the running attack and the consistency and what they've produced. But there it waits, November 30th, Matt.
Yeah, that's a big one.
You and wonder this, how they'll arrive to that point.
Well, and this team continues to get better tests, and they're defining themselves, and they're growing with great confidence. That's the biggest thing.
At Tennessee and then home against Georgia.
And then a good old bye week.
Before the Iron Bowl is back to being what the Iron Bowl always was. And here's Ricardo Lewis to midfield.
I remember years back when Alabama was having their way with this Auburn football team, when Bo Jackson showed up and changed all that.
Sure did. For Pat Tie-Dye.
There's a guy right at Trey Mason, 168 yards, four touchdowns. He was everything they wanted him to be tonight. Anytime they asked him for a big play, he responded.
Gus Malzahn's going to be in a lot of conversations for Coach of the Year. His first year back at Auburn, all the success he had as offensive coordinator. Cameron Artis Payne again. He weaves his way to about the 44, and you know, Malzahn's got a great sense of self, a real calm guy and organized, and well, he's really mastered the craft of what he's put forth. When you think about all the newfangled offense, this guy's one of the pillars of this era.
Yeah, because
what football's become.
He sticks with what he knows works. He doesn't deviate. Here's the key. What Gus Malzahn has done is he's put his kids in the position to do what they're capable of doing. He doesn't ask a kid to do something that he can't do. And that's just smart coaching. And you look across his roster, everything he's doing, the round hole gets a round peg. It's not a square hole, a square peg. So I think that is just a very simplistic approach, and it works. He believes in what he does. He's got the guys to believe what they're doing. And Tess, when that happens and that nexus happens, you can go a long way.
That bounces perfectly at the one and then gets touched up at the four. 61 seconds remaining, and here is Auburn, soon to be 8-1. on a night when Trey Mason played like an absolute superstar.
Well, they started early, and it never really stopped for him. And if you're watching at home and you're thinking, huh, that looks like the same play over and over. Well, Trey Mason makes it look that easy, number one. But number two, they don't do much of this offense. They're very simple. They stay with it. And Trey Mason, with his great patience and vision, he takes advantage of whatever the defense gives him.
Straight ahead is Jonathan Williams. And look at Williams giving that effort right to the end here. You like to see that on a team that's been struggling against a stretch in the SEC where they are playing five straight ranked opponents. They're headed towards six straight losses, but you fight to the very end.
Heck, I think that puts him over 100 yards himself.
It does. He has 104 on 15 carries. The freshman Collins had 84 yards rushing tonight. He will add to that. Ball came out at the end there.
He's going to have to work on that. They fumbled and lost a few of them tonight.
That's Auburn's ball, so they'll close out this game as Gabe Wright, their defensive tackle, came up with it. And Brett Bielema, he knows the long-term plan. First year at Arkansas here. Watch the end of this play. As Collins still down at the end of that play, Chris Frost came in and forced the fumble. And this is a big part of Bielema's master plan, having young talent like Alex Collins come into the program. He said recruiting's going fine. And you know the success he had up at Wisconsin, guiding them to three straight Rose Bowls, and he does it his way. Loves the power run game. Likes the discipline of an organization. But this is a tough stretch here in year one, Matt.
He's going to be fine, Tess. They've got some kids here who can play. He's got a roadmap that leads to the destination he wants to get them to. I mean, he's been there before. He understands how to do it. He understands the recruiting piece of it. I think he's a good head coach.
Of course, he's opposite a guy who everybody in these parts here in Arkansas, native of Fort Smith, is Gus Malzahn. They know how good of a coach he is. He was named the top assistant coach in football a few years ago at Auburn, won the Frank Broyles Award, and perhaps he's going to win the Bryant Award this year if things keep going in this direction. Tremendous turnaround by Gus Malzahn. You know, it's been a little heated between these coaching staffs. And Bielema's had a few issues with Auburn. And there was a little finger pointing earlier tonight from Bielema's side as he makes the walk out to congratulate Coach Malzahn.
Not a lot
on the wrong side of a 35-17 night. Auburn's 11th in the country. They are 8-1. Arkansas has lost six straight. Hope you stay tuned for ESPN College Football Finale. It'll be UTEP against number 12 Texas A&M as we say so long from Fayetteville and we get you out to College Station. Enjoy the rest of your night.